Greetings and welcome to Mountain Vista Unitarian Universalist. I am Susan Alexander and I am the pastoral assistant for today's service. Welcome to those of you who are here in person and also to those of you joining us on Zoom. For those of you joining us via Zoom, please note that the only time in the service we will see you is when we greet you. You can turn your video off and we will see only your name in case you're wearing something embarrassing. Welcome to whomever you are, wherever you are, to Mountain Vista UU. I'd like to take a moment to offer a special note of gratitude to our audiovisual team, Lee and Todd McMealy, Chris Tackett, our director of music, our minister, Reverend Matthew Funk Crary, our greeters, hospitality folks, our religious exploration team, and to the many others whose hard work facilitated us being in this beautiful space today. Today's service is titled Music for Our Times. For some, this might mean a funeral march, and for others, Hallelujah is most applicable. I suspect for most of us, it's a mix as we celebrate wins and commiserate over losses during the midterm elections. Over the past few months, my brain was hijacked by the rantings of politicians, political pundits, those who are sane and sensible, and those who appear as unhinged, self-promoting lunatics. What should be joy over political wins is more like a sigh of relief. It's over. It's time to take a breath. And another. My husband and I have been mulling over music for our times. We look to the music of the turbulent times 50 years ago that still seem relevant today. But there are some rather insightful lyrics from today's top 10 Billboard hits. In her song, Anti-Hero, Taylor Swift asks, "Did you hear my covert narcissism I disguise as altruism like some kind of congressman?" In the song, Cuff It, Beyonce tells us she wants to go where nobody's been. She wants to go missing and she needs a prescription. The number three song on the Billboard Top 10, getting past the profanity and liberal use of the N-word, addresses drugs, sex, and violence. Sadly, That song addresses the times for many people. I believe that change is our only constant. I also believe that the more things change, the more they stay the same. One thing I do know for certain is that I'm happy and grateful to be here, freely exercising my First Amendment right to worship as I choose. Let our hearts and souls, every fiber of our being, sing with delight at the opportunity and privilege of being together today. Hallelujah! Our chalice lighting words today come from Music Arises by Reverend E. Arland Goff. Music arises from depths unknown, often without words, but never without meaning. And spirit arises from deep within me, seducing my body to join the song. First a tremor in the soul, then tapping of toes. Breath aligns with breath, heart beats in syncopation, and a stuttering buzz in my throat becomes a hum. Breath with breath, beat with beat, and music and spirit arise together. Wed with hope and love and power, a song is born, bursting from my lips, a sweet, sonorous symphony. A melody joining with other souls, perhaps in tune, perhaps not, but a song still, arising from deep within and from community. Spirit moves, soul births song, and hope fills life. And I am not alone. How can I keep from singing?
Our opening sacred song is Turn, Turn, Turn by Pete Seeger, and the words will be projected. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join your voices together as led by Joel.
I invite you to join in harmony.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven.
A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to reap. A time to kill, a time to heal. A time to laugh, a time to under heaven. A time to build up, a time to break down, a time to dance, a time to mourn. Time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together. To everything, time for every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of war, a time of peace. A time you may embrace, a time to refrain from embracing. Everything turns. a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rend, a time to sow, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for peace. I swear it's not too late. To everything, turn, 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 there is a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven.
Thank you. You may be seated. I invite you to a time of contemplation, of considering and pondering, what time is it? What time is it right now for you? Now, presently, it is the year 2022 of the Common Era. It is November, the 11th month in the Gregorian calendar, and today is the 13th day of the month. And because we're all here together, it's a good clue that it is a Sunday. Here at Mountain Vista Unitarian Universalist, it is currently 10:44 a.m. Mountain Standard Time, and that's just in case people are joining us via Zoom outside the time zone. While this information locates us in the time and time zone, it does not state what time or season it is for your soul. As Unitarian Universalist, our friend Pete Seeger suggests in Turn, 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 to everything there is a season and a time and a purpose under heaven. This song is Pete's adaptation of the wisdom of Hebrew scripture, the book of Ecclesiastes. And he took 55% of the royalties for this song. Half because he wrote the music, and 5% for, quote, I did write 6 words and 1 more word repeated 3 times. And the rest he arranged to be sent to a peace organization in Israel. Because he says, quote, all around the world, songs are being written that use the old public domain material. And I think it's only fair that some of the money from the songs should go to the country or place of origin, even though the composer may be long dead or unknown. Now, the original composer, the voice throughout the book of Ecclesiastes, reaches us from nearly 2,500 years ago. The word Ecclesiastes is from the ancient Greek, which is in turn a translation from the Hebrew, meaning somebody speaking before an assembly. And so it's likely the ancient composer was a teacher who offered their experience, named their observations, gathered up some conclusions about life, and presented them to a people, which all was later immortalized in Scripture. And the teacher's conclusion: there is nothing new under the sun, and no one can possibly know God's intentions. Each human being must come to know their own times and their own seasons. And this is best done in the company of others, so that we can learn to be grateful for whatever comes. It's both an existential and spiritual book, grounding in human experience while releasing gratitude of the Spirit. For everything there is a season, a time, for every matter under heaven. Through Pete's addition of just one word repeated, turn, 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 we can join him in his own conclusions about our existence. There is a time for when you are in life, for accepting your current season. It may be a time of celebration. It may be a time of lamentation. But just as there is time for acceptance, there is time for change, a time for turning, for shifting, for moving from celebration to lamentation or lamentation to celebration. Think of that. You may be here this morning in your season of laughter or dancing or peace. You may be here today in a season of weeping or mourning or war. You may be living through a time of justice, equity, and compassion, or so immersed in injustice of our world and its impact on your life that all you can feel is anger and rage. Perhaps you are in a time when love holds you in all its tenderness and care, or you are knowing a time when it is gone, and you can only feel grief at its loss. A time of trust that those around you care for you, that no matter what, things are going to turn out all right. Or a time of being alone and afraid. What time is it for you? What time is it for your soul? Pete's invitation was never just to listen to his words, to have them immortalized in a song. He wanted us to participate. To paraphrase our chalice lighting, we share in a melody joining with other souls. Perhaps in tune or perhaps not. But a song still arising from deep within and from community. We participate together in a song as one community of faith. Our song certainly comes out of this community's past, individuals singing who are long gone, sadly, many who may even have been forgotten. It is a song all of us have joined and guides us through our celebrations and our lamentation, times of acceptance and seasons of change. It is a song that we are still learning. Learning to sing about our future. Notes and rhythm and melody that we are just discovering even today for those who will come that perhaps you or I will never know. And in this song, you are welcome. Your voice, your experience of life, your observations, your conclusions, your times and your seasons, all that you are, your whole and soul being, is welcome here. So, what season is it for you? Right now, here among these people at 10:51 a.m. Mountain Standard Time, what time is it for you? Seasons come and we accept them. Seasons change and we accept this too. And may this community then be a song, together holding every season, every time of change and all purpose under heaven. May it be so as we choose it to be. Our sacred song, I've Got Peace Like a River.
Peace Like a River comes from a genre of music that has commonly been called the African American spiritual, and it comes from the time of slavery. It's been co-opted by white Christian song leaders, largely as a children's song, mostly because of its flexible zipper format, of the zipper format of the lyrics, and the potential for, let's be honest, fairly silly hand movements. But make no mistake, it goes much, much deeper. As a song from the time of slavery, it of course has a subtext. It teaches young enslaved people, particularly young men, to put on a calm demeanor in face of their white oppressors, so as not to draw their ire. Stay calm, have the peace of the river, and live another day. As you know, rivers can appear quite calm on the surface, but often have deep and dangerous currents below what is visible. So too are the emotions of a black person being confronted by the white people who would consider themselves his superior. But to express these emotions in any meaningful way could have serious or potentially even fatal consequences. I can't help but draw the connection to what modern-day black and brown parents and teachers try to teach their children. How to behave when confronted by police or other white authority figures in situations where the power imbalance and the potential for violence is quite great. But that's a topic for another service, or two, or 10, and I'm sure we'll get to that in the very near future. The history of the spiritual in America is a very deep and often painful thing to study, especially for myself as a white musician and composer. I sometimes struggle with my place in the world of jazz for many of these same reasons. What we call a spiritual, though, also can be anything of at least four or possibly more distinctly different things. That's also a topic for another service, which I'm hoping we'll get to. We have it in the planning stages already. Some of my colleagues in UU world will not do these songs at all, unless they can put them in their proper historical context. I don't want to drop them completely from our repertoire because I feel like that does an even bigger disservice to them and their history. But neither do I want to ignore the deeper questions it brings up when we, as a mostly white congregation, sing them. I would say, with whatever power I have, sing them, enjoy them, take meaning and comfort from them, but know where they came from, and never ever forget how they got here.
With enthusiasm, either quiet or loud.
I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got pain like an arrow. I've got pain like an arrow. I've got pain like an arrow in my soul. I've got pain like an arrow. I've got pain like an arrow. I've got pain like an arrow in my soul. I've got tears like the raindrops. I've got tears like the raindrops. I've got tears like the raindrops in my soul. I've got tears like the raindrops. I've got tears like the raindrops. I've got tears like the raindrops in my soul. I've got strength like a mountain.
I've got strength like a mountain. I've got strength like a mountain in my soul. I've got strength like a mountain. I've got strength like a mountain. I've got strength like a mountain in my soul.
Our reading today comes from Connection as Resistance by the Reverend Erica Hewitt. In her 1975 theological treatise, Suffering, German liberation theologian Dorothy Zurla examines the way that suffering can knit human beings closer together and can draw us more fully into the process of loving. She uses the term apatheia, the inability to suffer, to describe the condition in which people become so dominated by the goal of avoiding suffering that it becomes a goal to avoid human relationships and contacts altogether. Isolation and apathy are forms of powerlessness. Both destroy, in Zurla's words, quote, "We are destroyed most thoroughly by that affliction that robs us of any possibility of loving any longer. The capacity that we need the most is the capacity to keep on loving," unquote. In pain and suffering, if pain and suffering tempt us to become isolated and apathetic, Zurla argues we must instead give voice to our suffering by creating a language of lament that might draw us into solidarity. The theology offered by Dorothy Zurla echoes that of her rough contemporary, Hannah Arendt, who was a political theorist rather than a theologian. One of Arendt's most well-known assertions from her book, The Origins of Totalitarianism, is that totalitarianism is organized loneliness, and that the seed of loneliness is isolation. Quote, "The experience of not belonging to the world at all, which is among the most radical and desperate experiences of human beings. Therefore, resisting the isolation that breeds loneliness is not just an emotional, psychological, or even spiritual act, but also a political one." The blogger and critic Maria Popova puts it this way: "Our insistence on belonging, community, and human connection is one of the greatest acts of courage and resistance in the face of oppression."
This morning, as a whole community in person and online, we will be practicing a new ritual of lamentation and aspiration. It is an act of compassion, an act of the heart, to invite and listen to our seasons of lamentation, embracing times of suffering. And it is an act of resistance, an act of our faith community to invite and to listen to our aspirations, our intentions to transform the world through love. To accomplish this ritual together in person and online, we will be using two pieces of technology, a smartphone or computer, whichever you have at hand, and the website called Mentimeter. easiest way to participate is to take out your smart device, even if you are at home. To use the camera and point it at the QR code on the screen. And we tested, you can reach it even from the back of this sanctuary if you focus in on it. Now, once you've focused in on the QR image, an option to go to the website should appear. Selecting it will automatically take you there. And alternatively, you can open a browser in your smartphone or computer and type in menti.com. And then when prompted, enter the number for our presentation, 6307-7028. All of this you will see on your screens. Oh, you're ready. Just hold on a second. Once we begin the ritual, you're all ready, yes. You will then be invited to share a lamentation or an aspiration using your device on that website. So if you've achieved the website, just turn to someone else, make sure they have as well. A few of you are assisting one another, helping one another get to this website is an act of community and compassion. Now we have a few more minutes before we begin, so no rush. We'll even come back to these instructions before we start. Assist one another as we prepare to share in a ritual of lamentation and aspiration. Preparing for our lamentations and aspirations, I invite you to a time of meditation, of breath, and of centering. Breathe in and breathe out as you are comfortable here in person, wearing a mask, or online in your home. Breathe in, and if you can, breathe out a little longer and rest in your body. Your body has seasons. Seasons of celebration, laughter, dancing, peace. Seasons of lamentation, weeping, mourning, war. Now may be your time of justice and equity and of compassion, or it may be your time for anger and rage. A time for love or a time for grief. A time of trust or a time of fear. A time of dignity or a time of shame. You know these seasons. You know them in your body. So breathe in your body and know what season it is for you today. Held in this community, breathe and rest in your season. We know that seasons change, turning and shifting. And as a people of faith, as Unitarian Universalists, we aspire to transform seasons of lament with love. Our faith guides us through and beyond lamentation. Where there is injustice, we seek liberation for all. Where there is isolation, we welcome the beloved community. And where we are at fault and make mistakes, we seek to learn and to grow. As the hymn says, my life flows on in endless song above earth's lamentation. I hear the real and far off hymn that hails a new creation. Through all the tumult and the strife, I hear the music ringing. It sounds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? We are not above life's lamentations, and yet we would not rush ahead. We would not leave behind those who are in a season of tumult and strife. In compassion and in care that can only arise here in community, we invite and we listen for the suffering, for the sorrow, beyond, among, and within our hearts. We gather our lamentations, we hold them, and with the strength of solidarity that we find here, we name our aspirations, and together we move forward. And so breathe. Relax into your body. Know your time and your season, and trust that we are together.
I'd like to invite the choir up. We're going to sing a piece for you by Ruth Huber, who is a friend and colleague from the Gala Choruses Network. She lives in San Jose, California, and she co-directs the Rainbow Women's Chorus. This is a piece called Courage to Be Who We Are, and it's dedicated to the memory of Gwen Araujo. Ms. Araujo was a trans teenager in Newark, California, brutally murdered at the age of 17 in 2002. She was killed by four young men who discovered she was trans. And in the subsequent court cases, two pled no contest to voluntary manslaughter charges. The other two were convicted of second-degree murder. In fact, it was one of the last times that the trans panic, a particularly vile variant of the gay panic defense, was used in court. And mercifully, it had no effect. Next Sunday is the annual Transgender Day of Remembrance, and we sing this in memory of all those lost to bigotry and violence. It's an easy piece. It's from the Justice Choir songbook, and I'd like to invite you to join in singing it with us. The tune is very simple and easy to pick up. The words also likewise follow a very simple formula. But you know, and y'all don't listen to this, I don't really care about the words. If you feel moved to sing with us, sing along on la la la, hum along, grunt along in rhythm, whatever you feel moved to do. The words don't matter. You know what's in your heart.
Thank you.
Listening is an act of the heart by the Reverend Leslie Takahashi. Listening is not an act of the ear. Listening is an act of the heart.
In these times when so much speaks, outrage, anger, disillusionment.
Rage is a constant cry. Derision has found his voice. The despair of the fair and faithful speaks fast and often. The whisper of despair grows into a keening lament.
Open our hearts to the real fears of those who have known hate, because they are our eyes to its insidious expansiveness.
Open our memories to those ancestors of our spirits who were love seekers, peacemakers, truth guiders, system questioners, and listen, because
listening is an act of our hearts.
Do not ignore the soul pain of the ones who move through the hardest nights, who face the denial of their rights and the desecration of their humanity. And do not forget those too dispossessed of the language of mastery and the countless life forms who do not count humanity as their family, and yet who are within our larger circle of interdependence.
Open our hearts to the true threats that many feel.
Open our minds to the anguish of those who need accompaniment.
Open our memories to those who came before us and taught us how to create new forms of love out of the old worn patterns.
And listen, because
listening is an act of our hearts. Listening is an act of our hearts.
We will share together our sorrows, the suffering that you know, the injustice and the isolation and the oppression, the anger and the grief and the fear. Now, as they appear, I will read each one aloud and add a stone to these waters, waters that symbolize our community. Estrangement from siblings. Death of a brother. I do not stay in communication with my brother more frequently. My marriage has ended, and I have chosen to live in the house together and raise my son. It is very awkward. Idiot election deniers. I lament by sharing, crying, and painting. Life is a process of continual change. Loneliness, few social opportunities, and living with health limitations and chronic pain, along with fear about politics and our country. Mother wanting to die. Grief of loved ones. Illness that cannot be cured. I lament the loss of a friend who died too soon. That this nation is divided against itself. All loved ones must someday die. The death of my son. Wishing I could do more in each day, have the energy. Exhaustion, broken time, promises. The over-aching heart that suffers from the onslaught of hatred. I wish I had taken health concerns more seriously when younger. That I can't always share my whole self, that capitalism endures, that not everyone has access to enjoy connection with nature. My lamentation is how reliant we are on our phones. Entertainment, news, games, mail, all get to be overwhelming. Sad about the ending of a romantic relationship with a beautiful person, too damaged by life to give or receive love. So sick of trying to rescue our failing democracy. Feeling emotionally empty. I miss the companionship of Jean, our fragile planet. That so many people are being duped by politicians into doing less than honorable acts. To live in a country unriven by suspicion, fear, hate, partisan righteousness, let there be peace and unselfish love. Too much poison, impersonal annihilation, casual destruction. My sister has been very sick. The war on Ukraine, understanding the hatred in our country. Honoring all citizens, civilians who have needlessly died from wars and oppression, 20 million in World War II, 600,000 in Vietnam, 40,000 in Ukraine, thousands of African Americans lynched, thousands escaping oppression in our desert. I grieve for those who are dealing with the loss of reproductive choice and health care. Injustice, oppression in our world. Widespread hatred that continues unabated in this world of ours, sadness, fear, and mistrust abound. I have no patience for people who force their opinions on others. I'm tired of pains in my body that won't go away. I'm not able to react with empathy and understanding soon enough. Losing friends, right and left. Loss of my husband, Jap. The lovelessness in this world that says it all. Joyful moments missed for the past years. Lamentations can be shared kindly in time of World Kindness Day. Missing Native American women, social injustices, divisiveness. My friend of 44 years is sinking into Alzheimer's. Too much hate in too many people. Fear of extremism. The ache of loved ones missing as we enter family gatherings and holidays. Grieving the loss of my son, uncertain about my health. A time of sadness as our daughter and son-in-law struggle in their marriage. A time of worry as our youngest daughter has difficulties in her pregnancy. I am missing family members I have lost deeply in recent days. Grief, political dissent, animal and human pain and suffering, racism, divorce, suicides, and the reason that lead to it. War, hatred, disease. After an intense journey of physical challenges, I am celebrating spring in my soul as I give birth to new healing in my body, mind, and spirit. According to Reverend Matthew, fall is one of the desert's springs for me after summer's burning. Suicide of a close friend. Injustice for the forgotten among us. the suffering of so many enduring war. Sadness for the earth, the damage and disrespect that causes death to so many creatures. The election for governor is so close. Missing generational stories. Letting go of my life so I can truly live it while I'm still here. My sister has been brainwashed and turned hateful by Fox News. Death cannot be understood. I miss being with my family. Aging family members. No lamentation, celebration of the trimp. I lament the ways we fear one another, the ways that we live in fear of being ourselves. I lament the ways our minds imprison our hearts. Difficulty with friendship due to political differences. Feeling isolation from people once called friends. Cruelty to humans and animals. Racial hatred. Anxiety, fear, anger, sorrow for the rejection of truth by much of humanity. Estrangement from siblings, idiot election deniers, illness that cannot be cured. I'm going to guess separation. Fear. My family navigates the grief from death of our troubled brother. I lament the world is ruled by elites who don't really care about all humanity. They care only about remaining in power and increasing their own wealth. My own deficiencies to see and feel much pain. It takes courage to share our lamentations. And it takes a community to hold them. Your voice may have been shared. It may have been heard. The notes of your song may have blended. And maybe not. Maybe the technology was too much this morning. Perhaps the lamentation is too deep to be given words. Whatever the case, I add a handful of stones. Lamentations that remain silent among our hearts. We cry out in grief at the suffering we see, says the Reverend David Breeden. People, all living things, the planet. Preventable suffering, and yet it continues on and on. And when we feel overwhelmed, we gather to find a path, to find a new way forward. When we feel overwhelmed, we know that to our right and to our left are the faces of caring. Faces of companionship, look around you. Joining together, we find our refuge, we find our strength, we find our wisdom, and we find our way forward. And so I invite you now to share your aspirations. What intentions do you hold? What actions are you inspired to live? As they appear, I will read them, and I will add more stones. More stones as a symbol that our community, it grows, it swells, not just from holding lamentations, but also from our aspirations. Chances for new joys in our world never expected. Peace, joy, love. Health and wellness, peace. feeling settled. I aspire to keep loving even in the face of no love for me. To be closer to my grown-up grandchildren. To be a whole person. Spreading the joy of connection through my art. More time in nature. To ease my own pain while spreading love and truth. Thank you. To live each day as a gift. Hope, belief, peace. To create a loving relationship. Loving more. To live fully and with gratitude. To reach out and join community. To express myself musically like I never have before. To have a closer relationship with nature. Our nation will heal and individuals will connect in love. To live fully with health and joy. More opening to possibilities yet unknown. Human liberation, connection, and unity once again. To see and hear and engage and love more. Community action, change, togetherness. To keep laughing, loving, sharing, and singing until my dying breath. Giving thanks for everything that occurs in my life. Friendships discovered at MVUU. To let go of fear, to be open, loving, nurturing self and others, connected, creative. Another many happy decades with my wife. To be closer with my brother. To become more involved in community with issues that matter. To be braver about being in a group. That Katie Hobbs and Chris Mays win the election. To support our family well. To build community in a place where we can grow together towards self-sustainability through interdependence, homesteading. To tend my own mental health, move forward, and grow as a person. To be gentle and caring with myself and with others. Agape. To open myself to the opportunities that come to heal people and planet. To live from the perspective of gratitude and patience, and act in joy for nature's enduring beauty. To keep learning, being in the present, reconciling the past, but continually striving for change and peace. To spend more time in nature and with my loved ones. That may I be more kind, more at peace, and help others. Cooperation finally overcomes competition. To love and to serve and to understand. Reaching a state of calmness, living each day for itself, to see the love of the Creator healing pain of humanity. So many aspirations. And more, aspirations that have not been named, that cannot yet be named, that perhaps due to this new method of sharing, people aren't quite ready for. Whatever the case, I add a handful and another and another. I had them all. I invite you now to a time of prayer adapted from the words of the Reverend Karen G. Johnston. May the invitation of prayer and meditation embrace this holy house, embrace all who gather together today, moving each and all to be connected with a sense of aspiration in whatever way your body knows to be true. Spirit of life and love, our hearts are overflowing with lamentation and longing, longing for a world with more hope and less despair, longing for more happy hearts and fewer hungry mouths, longing for a life more connected and less isolated, longing for a brave love, a growing seed within us spreading far and wide, longing for a future of less consumption and more compassion, longing for that right now. Longing for a government that quells hate and violence rather than generates it. Longing for a nation that acknowledges its injustices and works to make them right. Longing for a present with each of us doing what is ours to resist racism and all forms of systemic oppression. Longing for companions to give us the courage that we might be these people the times require and bring about the beloved community. In this circle of compassion and care, we faithfully witness those who have shared the laments with us. For each shared sorrow touches our hearts, and we accept the call to lighten the burden of another. In this circle of care and compassion, we hold to those who have shared their aspirations with us, for each shared intention is a form of resistance that moves us all forward. In these few precious moments of shared stillness, let our hearts pray the prayers that only they know. Prayer of the time that you are in. Amen. Our next sacred song is My Life Flows On in Endless Song, number 108, if you have a hymnal. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and follow along as Joel leads us. The words will be projected.
My life flows on in endless song. Lamentation, I hear the real, though far off, hymn that hails a new creation. Through all the tumult and the strife, I hear the music ringing. It sounds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? What though the tempest round me roars, I know the truth it liveth. What though the darkness round me close, songs in the night it giveth. No storm can shake my inmost calm, though to the rock I'm clinging. It sounds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? When tyrants tremble as they hear the bells of freedom ringing, when friends come singing. The prison cell and dungeon vile, our thoughts to them are winging. When friends by shame are undefiled, how can I keep from singing?
Please be seated. We have three announcements today. One from Hobie. Can I grab the mic? About our Thanksgiving gathering.
Thanksgiving afternoon at 2 o'clock, we're gathering here to have a potluck. Please contact me. My information is in the newsletter for phone number and email. Let me know how many people are coming with you. Let me know what you're bringing as a side dish. It can be a salad or dessert, green vegetables, whatever. We're going to serve smoked turkey and ham. Have that for you. We'll have a setup where you can bring hot pots to plug in to keep it warm. Please come prepared as if you're going on a picnic. Bring your plates and beverages and silverware and take them home, because we don't have a way of washing them here. That's right.
What time?
2 o'clock is when we start, and you'll be expected to help us set up the tables and expected to take them down when it's over, so it'll be all clean and neat when we leave. Thank you.
Thank you. Michelle.
Hi, I'm here to tell you about Choya Chow. It is that season. Many of you know about it. If you scroll down far enough in the newsletter, you'll see the article as well as a link. Choya Chow is a series of rotating dinners that give us a chance to connect even more. So I will be back in this room 15 minutes after service if people have questions or need to know more about it.
Thank you. As you leave this morning and go and join in our coffee fellowship, you'll have an opportunity to pass by our basket and our bowl. This is the place that we invite you to give your financial gifts to our congregation. The wooden bowl is for MVUU, and often people will put their pledge or add something to that in order to keep us afloat. The other, the woven basket, is a part of a partnership that we take place, that we participate in each month. And this month, our woven basket is for Emerge, the Center Against Domestic Abuse. Emerge believes that together we can build a community where everyone lives free from abuse. Now, their aspiration arises from the reality of domestic violence and abuse among families and homes in this community, in our community. Beyond the traditional approach of providing survivors with resources, including emergency shelters and safety planning and education, Emerge engages in an entire community in addressing the underlying causes of abuse, because they believe domestic abuse is a community problem and believe that our communities are our solution. All of your gifts in the bowl or the woven basket will be gratefully received. In the recent UU World periodical of our faith, the Reverend Dr. Susan Frederick Gray, president of our Association of Congregations, writes, "There are times in her daily morning meditation she feels the grief and loss of current tragedies. And at that time she breathes and remembers that like living cells in a larger body, it is natural that we feel the trauma of the world." And she encourages us then with these words, "Don't be afraid of the anguish you feel, or the anger, or the fear. because these responses arise from the depth of your caring and the truth of your interconnectedness with all beings. It is this caring that inspires us to engage the battles, big and small, global and local, for our future. And when we pay attention to our emotional realities in ways that remind us of our connections to one another, to our planet, they can be, they are the inspiration for sustained action in a world that needs our hope. We release the flame of our chalice, but not our lamentations nor our aspirations. May we carry our lamentations with us, seasons of suffering and sorrow, named here or still silent among us, as a community that aspires to act and transform them with love. May we hold our aspirations as seasons of change, connected to suffering and sorrow, as our inspiration to engage and to love and transform. May we carry all of this in our hearts, through our actions, into our world, until we are together again.